So, boy, talking about the war, we are going to talk Navy news now, and we're talking about the code breakers. How did code breakers change World War II and the war in the Pacific? What's the legacy of the Battle of Midway? Just this week, celebrating 70 years since that, we welcome in Captain Jim Fennell. He is the Deputy Chief of Staff for Intelligence and Information Warfare Commander, U.S. Pacific Fleet. Tell us first off, Captain, if you don't mind, how code breakers changed this? Because obviously December 7th, 1941, Pearl Harbor, sneak attack, and we're thrust into war. 6 months later, we fight maybe the most important naval battle in history. How did code breakers sort of change the war early on?
Well, Jai, the code breakers really were in place before December 7th. Okay. And in the preceding years, we had had people that had studied Japanese language and linguistic things back in Japan, and also had studied cryptanalysis back in Washington. And so a handful of those people were here on island. And after the attack, they were given authorities to study the Japanese naval codes that were able to tell us where the Japanese fleet was. And they spent that 6 months that you mentioned in intense labor, 24/7, in the basement over at Pearl Harbor, at Building 1, studying and peeling back the onion, if you will, one layer at a time, to break out each one of those code groups to get some understanding of the Japanese messages that were being sent across the radio waves.
This past week, we celebrated 70 years, and I know we have video with not just Pearl Harbor, obviously, in December that we celebrated, but also the fact that Midway, the Battle of Midway, how did they accomplish this? I mean, we're not talking computers and everything, but how did they get this done? Because these days, I guess we all rely on computers. They didn't have that back then, did they?
It was very manual intensive. There were radio intercept stations around the Pacific, some here on Oahu, and that radio traffic would be intercepted, put in paper, run down to the Pearl Harbor. It would go into the basement, and we would have people first look at it and try to break the codes. Those were the cryptanalysts, and then they would take that encrypted information and hand it over to Japanese linguists, who would then study it and then tell us where the Japanese were.
Man, we're taking a look at some of the old photos, and as you said, literally in the basement and working 24/7. What do you think is maybe the greatest moment for the code breakers?
Clearly the greatest moment was in the period in May when Joe Rochefort, the commander of the unit that was doing the code breaking, was requested to prove to the world that the designation AF equaled Midway. And so they devised a plan to radio out to the Midway Atoll and have them come up and radio and say that their water purification system wasn't working. And when they did that, they knew the Japanese would intercept that radio transmission and tell that story back to Tokyo, and they would reference AF would be out of water. And they did that. That was intercepted by our communications network, and that went back to Washington, and Admiral Nimitz was able to prove to the Chief of Naval Operations, Admiral King, that we knew that the Japanese focus of attention was on Midway Atoll, and that allowed Admiral Nimitz to get the permission to move our carriers into position. If we hadn't had that advance notification, Admiral King was not going to authorize Admiral Nimitz to put our forces in position, and we would have not been able to have that victory at Midway.
That's remarkable. So that one little thing there was proof, the fact that the water purification was not working.
Correct.
That is unbelievable. Captain, thank you so much for sharing this with us. And we appreciate what those brave Navy, what our brave military did 70 years ago in that Battle of Midway, and what it meant to not just Americans, but to the world.
Yes, it did.
Thank you, Captain. We appreciate that. Just remarkable stuff.